Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Grodi, your host for this program. The Journey Home program is about bringing into your lives the stories of men and women who, in their desire to follow truth, found themselves following Jesus Christ and then home to the church. And that wasn't always where they originally intended or ever expected or ever wanted to be, but in the journey, as they discovered a desire to follow Christ wherever he would lead, they've come home. And of course, that's the Journey Home program. So welcome to the program. Our guest tonight is Jeff Morrow. He's a convert from Judaism and Evangelical Protestantism. He's presently a professor at Immaculate Conception Seminary. Jeff, it's wonderful to have you on the program.
It's great to be here, Marcus.
And we've had, as we were discussing before the program, lots of similar friends, folks on the journey. We'll have to set that aside, although we'd love to talk about it in the program. But it's good to have you here.
It's good to be here.
Let me get out of the way and invite you to start at the beginning and give us a glimpse of your journey.
Sure. Gosh, the beginning. So if you had met me, how long ago was it, 1997, and you had told me that by 2016 you would be an associate professor at a Catholic seminary, married to a Catholic woman with five little kids, I would have said, you're out of your mind. When I entered college, I entered as what I would have called myself as a Jewish agnostic. So I grew up nominally Jewish. My mother wasn't Jewish. My parents separated at the end of my third grade year. And when I lived with my father, I was raised in a nominally Jewish home, went to Hebrew school for a little bit after school, had a bar mitzvah. And I always appreciated my Jewish faith, the Jewish traditions, that is, especially Passover. It was very important for me, probably the most important religious celebration that I experienced and participated in as a child. But really, the faith wasn't mine. It was more of an agnostic. I was very science-oriented and history-oriented.
So when you say you appreciated your traditions, it was the acts and the rituals and the rites of passage.
Exactly. And they were, for me, there was family traditions. Yeah. This is what I knew. They were family traditions about my, was there Moses? Did God part the Red Sea? Was there God? Probably not. But it was my family traditions. And so I was participating in the life of my family. That's how I understood it. And when I got to college, I was challenged by my freshman year RA. His name is Jason Shanks, who has been on this
program. Been on the program.
That's right. And he was a member of Campus Crusade for Christ, now called CRU, which is this parachurch Protestant organization on campus. And he was leading a Bible study in the dorm. And he invited me to show up one time because they had this debate on absolute truth versus relative truth. Does God exist? And so I was the heckler in the back of the room. But at the end, we had a long conversation. And I told him, I said, Jason, I don't believe any of this stuff. Why do you want me in your Bible study? He said, well, that's okay. Just, come in and show up. So I showed up. And I found out it was co-led by another man named Biff Rocha, who has also been on this program, who was a staff member of Campus Crusade, one of the few Catholic staff members there at the time. And I listened to the...
I mean, he himself is a convert.
He's a revert, that's right. He grew up Catholic and left and then came back.
Right.
That's right. And so I showed up, and when I started to hear that if Christ hasn't been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain, I started to realize, well, this is... The Christians believe Jesus rose from the dead. This is crazy. Growing up, even going to public school, I didn't know that Christmas had to do with Jesus until I was in the third grade, by the time my parents separated. But I didn't know that Easter had anything to do with Jesus until college, if you can believe that.
And I don't mean to distract, but even as a nominal Jew growing up, the issue of resurrection, life after death.
Never talked about it. Never came up.
No. So even a purpose-driven life was just, this is where we're at.
And I was very comfortable. I was very happy. I was a zoology major. I knew exactly what my future lay ahead for me. I was going to work with monkeys and apes as a primatologist studying human evolution. So my whole course of life was very planned out.
I mean, that really isn't just nominal. That's in a direction of a Darwinian evolution sees that everything here is by accident.
Totally. Completely, yeah. And I was very comfortable with that. I was very happy. It didn't require me to change my life. I was very comfortable. I was a good person, so I thought. And so I started to engage in dialogue with both Biff and Jason. And in many ways, Jason was my C.S. Lewis and Biff was my G.K. Chesterton. So I would stay up all night with them. Sometimes we would go to the Burger King and it would close at 4 a.m. and they'd have to kick us out because they're closing. We'd be in discussions. I started meeting with professors on campus and talking about these issues, historians, scientists, psychologists, scholars of religion, philosophers. And I started to read anything I could get my hands on. And what I started to recognize was if I was going to disprove to them that the Bible was the Word of God, to show them that Jesus didn't rise from the dead and God probably never existed. I had my work cut out for me. And that's basically a position I got to, because if they were so intent on showing me that, you know, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, as he claimed, I wanted to show them, well, you know, you guys are mistaken. So that's kind of what I did. So I just read everything I could. And at the end of the time, I came to three basic conclusions. One, there has to be some kind of God out there. I mean, we don't have time to go into all the arguments, but the Aquinas' uncaused cause was very important for me, that if we exist, regardless of if somebody believes in some form of evolutionary theory or not, right, there is no, it has to be an uncaused cause. You can't have an infinite chain of causes. And every effect has a cause, and that cause has to be greater than the effect. So that was very powerful for me.
And there are too many things in the evolutionary chain, if you put it that way, or the biological development of beings, that it just doesn't flow naturally, given the time we have, without some kind of guidance and cause to have set the director, the eyesight. I mean, just some stuff is just bizarre.
And that's recognized, I think, in a lot of the origin of life research. They usually say, well, at the beginning, we don't know. There's no good explanation for that. We kind of have to have a form of blind faith at that point. That's kind of what happens. And then as I studied the Bible, my initial thought was that the Bible was just a bunch of mythology, kind of like Hesiod's Theogony or something from ancient Greek mythology. And the difficulty was, as I began to study the Old Testament, the New Testament, in its historical context, I began to see that the Bible is the most historically trustworthy collection of documents from ancient history. If I was willing to just dismiss it all as mythology, I'd have to do the same thing with all of ancient history. And I wasn't comfortable and ready to do that. And there were a number of books, a number of texts helped me on that journey. But then I came to the really big question of, who is Jesus? Because I kind of had that view that you hear so often, oh, he's just a good Jewish teacher, good moral teacher. You know, he's just like every other religious teacher. But the more I studied about Christianity and his claims about himself, the more I realized that's just not possible, right? It's come to C.S. Lewis's conclusion that, you know, if Jesus existed and said the things that he said, he's not a good moral teacher. He's either the God who he claimed to be, in which case Christianity is true, the one God, or he's a nutcase, right? Or he's a very evil man leading all these people astray who lost their lives. I always think of St. Bartholomew because he was skinned alive, right? Of all the martyrdoms, that's the one that sticks out to me, skinned alive for his faith in Jesus. So when I started to study the resurrection, I didn't know what to do. I came across about 15 different explanations for what happened. And what I started to realize is none of the naturalistic explanations accounted for all of the historical facts of the death, the burial, the empty tomb. I'm reminded of Geza Vermesh's words. Geza Vermesh is a Jewish skeptic, of a scholar of the New Testament from Oxford University. And this is what he wrote. He wrote, and I quote, "In the end, when every argument has been considered and weighed, the only explanation acceptable to the historian is that the women who set out to pay their last respects to Jesus found to their consternation not a body, but an empty tomb." And he wouldn't go any further than that, and I understand why. What do you do with that? And part of the reason for that, as I found, was that women's testimony at that time was banned from courtrooms, Roman and Jewish. Right? So if a woman said something, the thought of the time, the culture of the time, was that, well, it can't be true. And yet women are the ones who are the first eyewitnesses of the empty tomb and the resurrection. So it actually, at that time period, that is the weakest argument for the resurrection. It's incredible. Now it becomes one of the strongest arguments and convinces most skeptics that at the very least, Jesus was killed, he was buried, empty tomb, we won't go any further than that. Well, I wasn't satisfied with that because that's, you know, so eventually I came to the conclusion that Jesus' resurrection is the only theory that adequately explains all of the historical facts.
Yeah, I remember when I went through a similar period, though, and I don't think I was as far way out there as you were, but I was through a couple years of scientific materialism college. It was a book of evidence that demands a verdict, which I'm
Jeff
sure
McDowell.
You read.
Sure.
Jeff McDowell's book, which is such a powerful, good collection of those, that level of apologetics that begins with, is Christianity real, Jesus, and all that. But for me, the issue was, could people die for a lie?
Right.
And that was just so confronted me. Those apostles, if they're historically real, did they die for a lie? Could they die? All those people die for a lie. remember that being such a big issue.
That was important for me too. People die for things that aren't true all the time,
right?
But they believe they're true. They're convinced. No one's going to get tortured to death for something they know is actually wrong.
Yeah, like Bartholomew.
Exactly. So I mean, that becomes an issue when, with one of the explanations that, well, the disciples stole the body. Actually, when you look at the New Testament itself, you can see this developing apologetic, and it actually becomes very historically powerful. So you see how it develops. The early Christians are saying, well, Jesus rose from the dead. And the response is, no, he didn't. And so what do the apostles say? Oh, sure he did. The tomb is empty, right? And the response from those who didn't agree were, well, that's because the disciples stole the body. They can see the empty tomb, right? Because they could all go and look, and sure enough, the tomb is empty. We know he was buried. The tomb is empty. And so then what the apostles responded, well, how could we have this, you know, there was the guard of the tomb. Ah, you did it while the guard fell asleep. So there's a lot of things that they concede there. And that's where that becomes important is that the disciples could not have fabricated this and died in the manner in which they died. So that was very powerful for me.
All right. Our guest is Dr. Jeff Morrow. All right. Well, so there you are in college. You got a couple guys hammering on you all the time.
Yeah.
And you're there punching bag willingly, but you're being pummeled.
I thought I was pummeling them, and that was
okay. All right.
That was the. But at the same time, they befriended me. They were very good friends. They really lived out this apostolate of friendship, yeah. Right? So they were really, really patient with me. Did a good job listening, and so that was a very, very important, I think. And then, you know, I confronted the issue of what about these other religious traditions? So I studied Buddhism and Hinduism and Taoism. I studied Islam. And so the various major world religious traditions, because that was one of these other views. Okay, fine, this might be all true, but are all religions the same? Are they just, you know? And so what I started to realize is that on many moral issues, not all of them, though, they do teach very similar things. But their cores are incredibly different. I mean, you can look at the issue of Jesus himself. Did Jesus die on the cross? Well, if Jesus died on a cross, I couldn't be a Muslim, because Islam says Jesus is our prophet, and he did not die on a cross. So for Islam, for example, if something in history contradicts the Quran or Muslim teaching, or if something in the Bible contradicts the Quran and Muslim teaching, well, that's because the devil came back in and changed those documents. So that was hard for me. Yeah. I started to realize that as a skeptic, it would take me more faith as I investigate these traditions to be any of these other traditions than Christian. So I had to deal with that. You know, I had a lot of emotional baggage, you know, because coming out of even a nominally Jewish background, most of my closest friends were Jewish. I got beat up a lot as a child when I was at school for a few years, where I was the only person who would take off for Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, the holy days. And so when people found out that was what was going on, I got roughed up a little bit. So I had a very kind of an emotional bias against Christianity. And I had to recognize it at an intellectual level. I had an anti-supernatural bias as well. Almost any explanation would be good, except the Christian explanation. So I had to kind of get over that. I think the Lord helped me with that. One other person who helped me, his name is Donnie, really was at that last stage where I knew this was true. In fact, a month before, in November, I remember they got permission with Campus Crusade, and they asked me to do an open forum debate. And I said, but what do you mean? What position would I argue? They said, well, you would argue the Christian position. Just give the Christian position, as strong as you can make it. I said, but I don't believe any of this stuff. Are you sure? They said, yes. So we had open forum debate. So we had philosophy majors come over, some graduate students. We had everybody came over to the dorm. And so I start, here's the basic Christian message. Here's why, it might be true. Here's some arguments. And they were arguing, and I was disturbed, because I kind of thought, I accepted this because I thought, well, somebody smarter than me will come around and help me show why this isn't true. And they weren't able to do that. And that was really scary for me. And at one point, one of these philosophy students rose his hand. Well, you're only saying this because you believe this stuff, because you're a Christian. I said, I'm not a Christian. I don't believe any of this stuff. You know, I actually want you to help me shoot this down. That's what I'm trying to do. So I left that very distraught. And then my friend Donnie came along one night, and I was just telling him, look, I know this stuff is probably true, but I'm not sure I can place my faith in Jesus. And so he was very encouraging. And later that morning, December 5th, 1997, I did what evangelicals call accepting Jesus as my Lord and Savior. So I started following, I made a commitment to follow Jesus. And then I got to experience my first real physical miracle, in the sense that Donnie, later that day, I wasn't able to tell him about my decision, because he got in a horrible car accident, and he lost 75% of his blood into his belly. His renal vein ripped off his kidney. and it was really bad. So he, you know, usually you die at that point. And they gave him a blood transfusion, and his blood, his body rejected the blood transfusion. Mm-hmm. So we all gathered and we prayed for him, and sure enough, he, despite the doctors thinking he was gone, he survived. And so I was a new follower of Jesus.
Well, yeah, reflect more on that transition. When we think about conversion, we often think about, when we ask somebody, you know, what brought you to Jesus, you'll say grace.
Yeah.
And then we look at those that don't, well, they're stubborn, they're ignorant, they're written. Well, wait a second, there's this tension here.
There is.
And you're talking about a transition in your life from disbelief to belief to surrender to Jesus Christ and all of that. Talk about that.
Well, initially, it really was this intellectual game, and then it became very serious, and it became very scary, very scary. Mm-hmm. Because I started to realize that I'm reading John down the cross, and he thinks a dog probably ate Jesus' body. I'm reading anything I can get my hands on, and I'm noticing that the Christian argument is more persuasive. That scares me. So I got very frightened. I didn't know, you know, this could change my life because there's implications here. And I just didn't know what to do. I had to rest. What's my family going to think? What are my friends going to think? What am I going to do? And I don't know what to say. I just noticed that the obstacles left. God took the obstacles away. You know, I knew this is probably true. I had in few things, probably in nothing, do we know with absolute certitude, especially the things that matter most, marriage, whatever. We don't know in absolute certitude that we can do these things. This is the right decision to make. So at some point, we need help making that decision. We just have to kind of jump in. And that's what I did. And then everything changed because now I knew, well, this is true, regardless of how I feel. It changes everything. It's a game changer. At one level, it almost took me less faith to become a Christian at that point, because I was experiencing such cognitive dissonance, that was almost the easiest answer. But then afterwards, it takes incredible faith. What other tradition calls you to be a saint? And who am I kidding, man? You know? But God can do it.
That's our trajectory, hopefully, by grace.
Yeah.
But it's like Screwtape Letters in C.S. Lewis's brilliant book, where as soon as the person converts, yeah, it awakens the enemy.
Sure, yeah.
You know, the battle comes in, yeah. The challenge is internal, external, all the things say, wait. You know, that was dumb, or you were misled, and all the battles that come in to try and pull you away from our Lord.
Yeah. I didn't have those. I had other battles. We don't have to go into all the details.
Yeah,
but,
right.
Yeah, but those, I never really had many temptations at that point on the intellectual level. A lot of challenges and a lot of people, you know, challenging me. I got to have a coffee with my rabbi, and it was good. It was good. And as the years progressed, certain things tweaked. My understanding of certain prophecies from the Old Testament, I started saying, okay, maybe I didn't understand this exactly as I understood it initially. But the more I've studied, the more the history is increasingly supports the Christian claims, Jesus' claims about who he was. That was very important. The transition to Catholicism was a whole other thing.
Yeah. How long were you evangelical? Yeah.
Oh, it was, let's see. So I entered Easter Vigil, let's see. So accepted Jesus December 5th, 1997. Entered the Catholic Church Easter Vigil 1999. That's when I was baptized.
Okay, so a couple years in that you were.
But I was moving very rapidly. These are very intense journey. It was a very intense journey. And all of my major decisions, marriage, becoming an evangelical, becoming a Catholic, were very brief periods of time, very intense.
Now, Biff at the time, to bring him up, who was one of your mentors there.
Yes, right.
He had already
returned
to the church.
He had returned to the church, and Jason Shanks entered with me. We entered the same Easter Vigil, in fact.
All right.
So, yeah, actually, this is, you know, I should transition and say, you know, the way I've been telling the story thus far is how I've historically told the story. Very cerebral, very intellectual. Now, I tell it a little differently usually. I don't start with my story. I start with Jason's, because I start to realize that the power of prayer changes everything. Because I'm the hard soil. I'm not that fruitful good soil that Jesus talks about. I'm the rocky soil, and I'm all these other soils. But to make that transition, God had to make me, at least at a time, the good soil. And we had to work on that our whole lives to be receptive to the Word of God. And I was not coming in. Jason, the year before I entered college, was all intent on becoming the president of the student body. And he was set up to do that. He thought, this is how I'll make an impact for Jesus. And it didn't work. And he met Biff Rocha because Biff was seen as the top apologist on campus, the top defender of the faith, the most intellectual Christian on campus, even though he was Catholic, if you can believe that. So he was distraught. What can I do? I lost the presidential race. How can I have an impact for Christ on the campus? And he decided to be an RA and lead a Bible study. So he and Biff spent that entire summer studying theology, studying scripture, studying church history, and praying and fasting for that future Bible study. Now, as I'm sure you know, if you get a freshman Bible study of 9 members on a state school, that's pretty good. We had 40 members. There were 40 members of that Bible study. 9 of us came to faith in Jesus for the first time. 3 of us, including Jason, entered the Catholic Church. One, Eric Rausch, Reverend Mister, is going to be ordained a priest for the Archdiocese of Cincinnati this year. Yeah, so it's kind of amazing. And I really do attribute that to their prayer and fasting. As important as the arguments were, right, the Holy Spirit worked and was answering their prayers, both their praying and their fasting. They're praying with their senses for all of us.
Well, you brought up that parable of the soils, where all of them heard, but they didn't all understand.
That's right.
In that parable.
Yeah.
You know, and that understanding is a gift of grace that awakens us, that comes as a result of prayer. I mean, so that you're just affirming the way the Lord works.
Yeah.
And I mean, the message is out there to our audience. I mean, if you've got a friend who doesn't know Christ, doesn't know the church, what's the first thing you do? You pray for them.
Sure.
But there's a second thing that happened too, is that they befriended you.
Yeah, very important. And I mean, don't give up. You can't give up.
That is such a powerful witness for what they did to you to help you discover Christ and be a channel for His grace in your life.
Yeah, it was very important. And of course, Jason at the time was not Catholic. And so now I entered the world of Christianity. Where do I go? How do I worship God? What should I believe on some of, what do I do? So I would go around to different churches and attend their different services, the independent Bible church in the area and other churches, the Methodist church, etc. And I attended the Catholic Church. Biff walked through the Mass, showing what was going on in the back. And it was funny, actually, Jason's response was, "This is about an hour long. This is really long." Because he was used to a shorter independent Bible church service. And I was like, "This is pretty short. I'm used to a 2.5-3 hour Saturday morning synagogue service." So this was kind of interesting. But I got to see really the Jewish tradition fulfilled, come to its full fruition in the Mass. It was amazing for me to see that. And I had a lot of help. I mean, I got to, at the time, Scott Hahn hadn't written many books. He had his conversion story. He had, this is 98, he had a Father, He Keeps His Promises, but that was it. 99 is when The Lamb's Supper came out. But he had published these audio cassettes.
Right.
You remember those?
Oh, of course.
The Bible studies, Genesis, Gospel of John, Gospel of Matthew, these, hours of basically recordings of his courses on Scripture. And so I would listen to those, and I would take notes, and I would read scripture, and I would read the encyclicals of Pope John Paul II, St. John Paul II, very important. Joseph Ratzinger had come out with Called to Communion.
Yeah.
It's very powerful stuff. So I was reading Peter Kraft, and you mentioned Screwtape Letters. He had the Snakebite Letters.
Yeah.
Great stuff. And so I started to recognize how the Catholic Church was more biblical than the Bible Christianity I was experiencing with my Protestant brothers and sisters. And it was interesting because, I was developing friendships with pastors and others, and since that time as well, and you often hear from this Lutheran pastor friend of mine, well, that doesn't really matter. I mean, we're all just Christian. I mean, nobody knows what Jesus intended. And from a Protestant perspective, that makes lots of sense.
Yeah.
If you're a Lutheran, you don't claim that Jesus founded the Lutheran Church. No, Luther, right, founded this with Melanchthon's help. And we're just doing the best we can. And so a lot of my Protestant friends, including the ministers, will often say, well, we're just doing the best we can to do what the early church did, or where this fits, what I already kind of hold. I can live this out. The Catholic Church, I can't live all those rules and all that stuff. That's just too difficult. Or, it doesn't really matter. But the Catholic Church is different. The Catholic Church in many ways is like Jesus compared to other religious leaders, or Christianity compared to other religions. The claims are too big for it to simply be just one among others, right? If Jesus is, he claimed to be the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father but through me. If that's not true, it's really not true. The worst anti-Christian slurs are true if that's not true. What's the same with the Catholic Church?
Yeah.
The Catholic Church claims to be the one true church, the church that Jesus founded. If that's not true, it's not a little wrong. It's really wrong. The worst claims of anti-Catholics are true if we're wrong. So I had to wrestle with that. And so I started studying Scripture in its original historical context. I started reading the early church fathers. Ignatius of Antioch was especially important. I started to see that, gosh, the early Christians, right after the apostles, they believe in the real presence of Jesus, the importance of the Blessed Virgin Mary, the role of the bishop. They have a hierarchical church. That was very important for me, reading St. Augustine. I started studying medieval theology. I started reading Martin Luther, right? Martin Butzer and Philip Melanchthon and John Calvin, the early Zwingli, the early reformers, the Protestant reformers. And I started recognizing what surprised me was how Catholic so many of the reformers were. Yeah. Martin Luther had a very strong devotion to the Blessed Mary, Virgin Mary, and he believed in a form of real presence in the Eucharist. And I was always told these were these medieval creations of the Catholic Church, and yet Martin Luther held those even after his excommunication. And at the same time, I started to notice how unbiblical some of their teachings seemed to be in contrast to Catholic teaching. So his problems initially with the book of James, for example, and the role of works in justification, chapter 2, right? So you always hear that trope, we're saved by faith alone, we're justified by faith alone, and yet, as you know, the only part of the Bible where that phrase, faith alone, occurs is James 2:24, where you're not justified by faith alone, but by works. What's going on here? So that became an issue for me, as I started to realize that the Catholic Church claims it's the church Jesus founded. And I became convinced that that's, in fact, true. And some of the big issues were the authority issue. We're not going to have time to go through all the issues of Mary and purgatory and, you know,
what
baptism.
I'm going to do is,
please.
Let's hold those till after the break, because I want to just deal with a couple, two, three, those key issues.
Sure.
So let's just pause those. We won't take a break just for a second yet, but for another minute. So with all the issues.
Yeah.
What was the final kick in the pants that brought you into the church?
The final kick was the weight of all of it. It was the same sort of thing as, well, you know, Aquinas' argument for God, not on its own, it's powerful, but it's not enough.
Yeah.
But when you take that and the trustworthiness of Scripture and Jesus' resurrection, right, it's this whole package deal. Well, the same sort of thing happened with Catholicism. It's, you know, it's not just one issue, it's they're right here and there and there. They're not just more biblical. It's like it's coming right out of the Bible, right? And so then, you know, so probably the canonization of Scripture became one of the most central things. If you're convinced, if you believe the Bible is the Word of God, right, and then you start to recognize that it's the Catholic Church, it's these bishops who help determine which books belong, which books don't. Well, if they're right there, why aren't they right here, yeah, and the other books?
I mean, that really is an amazing question mark with so many of our good separated brothers and sisters who love Scripture, proclaim it like we're so influenced with you, but really are not sure where it came from,
right,
or the authority behind it, why these books, why the order of those books, why we take them for what they say versus just approach them like modern critics and just look at them as just any other book. You know, all of that takes us back to the church, and it's amazing that often doesn't come across their thinking.
Right.
As they do exegesis and prepare for their homilies or write their books. So let's take a break now, and we'll come right back and deal with some of these very issues that you've mentioned. All right, see you in a bit. Welcome back to The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Grodi, your host, and our guest tonight is Jeff Morrow. And so I paused you. Let's pick up. First of all, let's make sure you're in the church. Talk about it actually coming into the...
Well, that was amazing. I mean, I can't adequately describe, but the Easter Vigil was, you know, I got baptized, confirmed, and received my first Holy Communion for the first time. And I had been going to Mass many times during the week, but unable to receive our Lord the Blessed Sacrament, even though I had the faith of a Catholic at that point. I believe this is true. So that had been very difficult, and I started to see it as an engagement process. The whole RCIA program became an engagement for me, because I fell in love with the Catholicism of the books, and now I was experiencing Catholicism lived in the pews. And it was a different thing. But it was beautiful. It was amazing. And I remember the liturgies leading up to that, the Good Friday, and getting to read in the liturgy one of my favorite passages from the Bible, the suffering servant from Isaiah, which actually played an important role in my initial conversion, because I remember reading this out of context And somebody asked, well, where do you think this is from? I said, oh, probably one of the New Testament books. He's like, no, this is the book of Isaiah. We have a copy of that from over 100, over 200 years before Jesus was born. And it describes a servant of God who was beaten, who died for our sins, and who saw the light of life. So that was very powerful for me. And then the Easter Vigil
itself.
Which
is amazing that so many Jews don't see.
Well, yeah, it's understandable, though, as I study more of the history of interpretation within Judaism, the more common Jewish interpretation is that this is the collective people of Israel, right? Which is probably the most popular view. And Rashi, the medieval sage, argued that. But the earliest Jewish view is that this is about the Messiah. And that's, you know, in Targum Jonathan, one of the early Aramaic interpretations. That's in the Talmud. The Jewish Talmud sees Isaiah 53:13, 53:12 as pertaining to the Messiah to come off in the future, as did Moses Maimonides, the medieval great Jewish sage from the medieval period. But it is an irony, and there's, you know, lots of interpretations there. I think it's clearly seems to be about an individual, right? And when you see Jesus' life, I mean, it fits that so well. So that was very powerful for me. And then the Easter Vigil itself, all of the readings from the Old Testament, all of the readings from the New, and then the symbols of the light walking down the darkness, the light coming in the darkness, the baptismal candle, and the baptism itself, the water, and the readings of the past, you know, the Exodus event. It was so powerful. I felt like I was seeing lived in front of me and participating in all of salvation history all in one go. So the Easter Vigils remain my favorite liturgy of the church's year. We even usually get a babysitter, you know, for the little ones, that we can make sure my wife and I go to the Easter Vigil every year. It was amazing. So I remember being baptized vividly, and Biff was there, and Jason was being baptized somewhere else. And not baptized, I'm sorry, he was being received into the church. He had already been baptized. And then I was confirmed, and then receiving our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament for the first time, really, I can't describe it. It was amazing, and finally, right?
Yeah.
And then, then I was a Catholic, and in the confessional the next Saturday. And I kept that tradition up of, you know, frequent communion and weekly confession, and it was a whole new world for me. It was great. And I continued to study, and I became a double major in comparative religion and ancient Greek, and then I went and studied theology. It was great. And the arguments that helped me the most, there were so many, but the ones that helped me the most were probably with the authority of the church. The ones that drew me the most were the Eucharist. But the authority of the church, what it really came down to, I started to see the differences. There's a lot of differences. The differences are based on interpretation of Scripture. How do we understand these various passages? Sometimes there's some ambiguity. It's kind of difficult. What lens are we using to interpret these passages? Mm. Other times, it's a little bit more clear. And I think especially when you understand the New Testament in its Jewish context, it becomes very clear on a lot of these issues. So I was being told that, well, you don't want to follow traditions of men. You want to follow the Word of God, which is the Scriptures. And I thought that was odd, because when you look at the Scriptures, so much authority is given specifically to apostolic tradition. Right, so St. Paul, for example, as you well know, in 2 Thessalonians 2:15, doesn't say, stand firm, brothers, and hold to the Scriptures I write. That's not the only thing he says. He says, stand firm, brothers, and hold to the traditions that we have passed on to you, whether by word of mouth or in writing. Well, that doesn't seem to fit the paradigm I was being given by my evangelical brothers and sisters, as well-intended as they were. Or, you know, that classic passage from 1 Timothy 3:15, right? The church is the pillar and foundation of truth. And that's in Protestant translations as well as Catholics. But for me, the biggest one was the papacy. Because really, you can look at the different churches out there, and in a lot of ways, the Eastern Orthodox churches and the Oriental Orthodox churches are very similar to the Catholic Church. We recognize each other's sacraments, legitimate apostolic succession. Their bishops, you know, come back from the apostles of Jesus. But it's the papacy that becomes the dividing point, the authority of Peter and his successors. And I noticed something very interesting. When you look at some of the very good Protestant scholars, right? William Foxwell Albright, right, who was a Methodist. D.A. Carson, who's a Baptist. Edwin Yamauchi, who's an evangelical, is a president of the Evangelical Theological Society back in 2006, I believe. Bruce Metzger, the great Presbyterian. They recognized that Peter held a role of primacy among the apostles. They don't grant that to his successors. They don't grant apostolic succession. But they recognize that, you know, when we have arguments against Peter's role, that tends to be an overreaction to Catholicism, and they're very upfront about that. But then when you look at the Orthodox theologians, they'll say, well, we don't necessarily agree with his primacy in juridical matters, but we agree that there was apostolic succession, right? The bishops are the successors of the apostles, and they can go to Scripture and show that. And what I started to see is the Catholic Church combined both historical views and did so very well. And that seems to be how it played out in history. And so when you look at apostolic succession, I mean, Judas gets replaced. His office has to be replaced. Well, if that's the case for Judas, how much more Peter, right? And so this is what we see. We see the apostles having successors. So Timothy, the bishop, becomes the successor, a successor to Paul, etc. And when I looked at the scriptural passages with Peter, I couldn't understand how you could read this any other way than the Catholic reading. I remember talking to a Lutheran pastor friend of mine, and he said, Jeff, he said this in good faith. And I think sometimes we're just blinded by our own views. We miss things in Scripture. I know I miss things, and you know the Holy Spirit brings it to my attention. And so I should work on that. Well, he said, Jeff, if Jesus intended anything even remotely like what Catholics believe about the papacy, don't you think he'd take Peter aside at some point and just kind of single him out in some way? And he said that. He said, I kid you not. And so we just walked through Matthew 16 and John 21 and Luke 22. And they're amazing passages, right? So Matthew 16, Jesus calls his apostles here. And, you know, some of this has been pointed out to me later. I didn't even know all of this at the time. I knew enough to see Peter as, right, Jesus' representative, his royal steward, right, of the kingdom.
Again, back to Isaiah.
That's exactly right, Isaiah 22. But I didn't, there's so much there. There's much more than that. I've benefited from Brant Petrie and others since then to see that what Jesus is doing is very interesting. He's the son of David. That's emphasized again and again, especially Matthew's gospel. And as a son of David, like Solomon, he's gathering around 12 royal ministers, as Solomon had 12 royal ministers, as there were 12 tribes of Israel. And so those 12 apostles represent the kingdom of Israel, the 12 tribes. They don't all come from the 12 tribes, right? John and James are brothers, right? But they symbolically represent the 12 tribes. And in the Old Testament, the kingdom of Israel followed an ancient Near Eastern pattern where they had one royal minister who had the keys of the palace. And he wielded the king's authority. And as we see in Isaiah 22, he was called a father, a pope, an Av. The term means father, which is the same term that Joseph uses for himself in the kingdom of Egypt in the book of Genesis. So there's a parallel going on there, that the kingdom of Israel set itself up very much like its neighbors did. And so what Jesus is doing is transforming that. He's not abolishing. He's entering into the middle of Israel's history, and he's transforming it from within. And so what he does is he says, you know, who do people say that I am? The Son of Man is. And they say, some say Elijah, John the Baptist, one of the prophets, Jeremiah. He says, who do you say that I am? And he speaks in the plural there. Who do you all say that I am? And Simon Peter responds, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus responds to him, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And we can go into, you know, that's not that important right now. We can go into a little bit. You know, if you see in John's gospel, he's the son of John. John and Jonah are different names. But it's interesting that that phrase in the Greek text is kept in Aramaic, bar Yonah. It's not translated. And I think that's because in Hebrew and Aramaic, Jonah, Yonah, means dove. And of course, go back a few chapters, we saw a dove, right? And the question again is Jesus' identity. When Jesus is baptized, his identity is revealed. The Father sends the Holy Spirit like a dove. Behold my Son, in whom I am well pleased. And what happens in Matthew 16? Who do people say that I am? And we see Peter say, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Blessed are you, Simon, son of the dove. For flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. It's a Trinitarian event. God the Father has revealed the identity of the Son through the Holy Spirit to Peter. And then he renames him. He names him Peter. Nobody had been named Peter before. Right, he names him Rock. You are Petros, Rock, or Kepha in the Aramaic. And upon this Rock, this Petra, this Kepha, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not overcome it. And I will give to you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. What you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. What you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. This is very interesting. Historically, Protestants made a big deal about this Petra. Right. Yeah, you're a pebble, and this is the big rock over here.
It's even in the footnotes in the RSV.
Is it really?
Yeah. It's
well, it's hard to maintain it for a lot of reasons. One, you have the Semitic parallelism. You are Peter. Upon this rock, I'll give you the keys of the kingdom. No, it's you are Peter. Upon this rock, I will give to you the keys of the kingdom. In Aramaic, if he was speaking Aramaic, which most scholars assume, there would be no distinction. You are Kepha, upon this Kepha, you know, I will build my church. There's no way to distinguish. There's no gender there. I think Petra is there for an important reason, because we saw Petra not that long before in chapter 7 of Matthew, the wise and foolish builders. Right, the wise man, Solomon, the son of David, right, that's the implication there, built his house on rock, the temple. This is an allusion to the temple, that Solomon, the son of David, is the wise man of the Old Testament, and he builds his house on rock. The temple was seen as built on a rock, the Evan Shetiyah, the rock, so it becomes the temple on a firm foundation. And it's the Petra, because again, that's the term in Greek that was associated with the rock that the temple was built on. So what's going on in the text of Matthew is there being a link being made with the Petra and the rock of Matthew 7 to show that Jesus' work of building the temple, Jesus' work of building the church is building a new temple. And I think that's key. And so his name gets changed to Petros because you can't call him Petra. It's like Josephine. I prefer Joseph, right? So he's being given a masculine form of the name because the name is in the feminine. So that's what's going on there. And of course, the keys go back to Isaiah 22. You look at Jewish texts like Sifri of Deuteronomy. This is a Jewish interpretation of Isaiah 22. We find this very interesting passage. In Isaiah 22, a very similar thing is going on. Hezekiah is the king in the background, although he's not named, and he has these royal stewards, one of which is the prime minister, Shebna, and he's being replaced here by Eliakim. And Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, is given his robe, he's given his signet ring, and he's given the key to the house of David. And it says, what you open, none shall shut. What you shut, none shall open. Now, what's really interesting about this, and a lot of people don't mention this, is that in the Jewish context of Jesus' day, there was a very common phrase which we see him use in Matthew 16, and that is binding and loosing. Mm-hmm. Rabbis had the authority to bind and loose. It had to do with forgiveness of sins, had to do with what's clean and unclean, interpretation of Torah, boundary mark, you know, excommunication, stuff like that. And in Sifri of Deuteronomy and other Jewish texts, we see that link, that authority to bind and loose, was linked explicitly with the opening and shutting of Isaiah 22. So that whole concept of binding and loosing is linked back to Isaiah. So what Jesus is doing is entrusting his keys of the kingdom, the Davidic kingdom, right? The kingdom of Yahweh, the kingdom of the Lord, with Peter.
You know, that reminds me simply that sola scriptura alone, your average person opening their Bible and reading Matthew 16, and then on their own deciding, I'm going to interpret that what it means.
Right.
When done apart from the bigger tradition, it's hard to make those connections.
Sure.
With the Old Testament foundations that really bring all the sense to it.
It is. It's very hard. If you remove the New Testament from its Jewish context, we're lucky we have the Catholic context that shows the same thing.
Yeah.
But apart from that, you know, you can't understand the new without the old. And that's so important because the New Testament is citing the old and alluding to the old throughout. And so that's very important. If you miss that, you miss exactly what Jesus is doing. If you don't know the Passover, how can you understand the Eucharist?
Yeah.
Right.
Or again, if you're just a regular believer reading the Bible,
right,
you're not always going to remember, well, let's see, where did I see that before? So you're left to have to be a scholar.
That's right. Yeah.
The only way that an individual sola scriptura believing Bible only Christian is to be the ultimate scholar, to remember everything that's there, to at least still just get a piece of the puzzle.
Right.
You're not getting the apostolic deposit of faith that our Lord passed on when he met with his apostles in the resurrection appearances.
Right. Yeah, and this is, and the other thing that really drew me was connected to this was the Eucharist, right? So when you look in Luke 22, and it's in the context of the Last Supper, right, that Jesus says, you know, Simon Peter, right? Simon, Simon, Satan has determined to sift you like wheat. Actually, a lot of English translations don't do a very good job here because the you there is plural. So there's a distinction going on here. It's a very important passage. Simon, Simon, Satan has determined to sift all of you like wheat. But I have prayed for you, and it's in the singular in Greek. Mm. I have prayed for you, Simon, that when you have returned, strengthen your brothers. So we see, again, you know, the strength in the context of the Last Supper, this Passover meal. And again, in John 21, we have this after the resurrection. Peter has denied Jesus three times. And what happens? Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? What does he say? Feed my sheep. Tend my lambs. Feed my lambs. Right? Well, who does that? Shepherds. Well, that's interesting because John's gospel talks about Jesus as the good shepherd. Right? And of course, in the Old Testament, God is the shepherd of Israel. A lot of important shepherd figures throughout the Old Testament, including King David. So it shouldn't surprise us that Jesus sees himself as the good shepherd. God come among us to feed the flock. And now what he's doing, at the very end of his public ministry, before he ascends to heaven, after his resurrection, he entrusts his shepherding ministry to Peter to feed us. And of course, how are we fed? Lots of ways. One of the keys is the sacraments, and chief among them, the Eucharist. So the Eucharist, once I understood what the Eucharist was, I started to get drawn to it. I mean, I really wanted understanding this as the fulfillment of the Passover, of all the sacrifices of the Old Testament. That now what we have is very interesting, that the sacrifices pointed forward to something new. I mean, you can think about this with any of them, like the circumcision, right? As Paul points out, you know, Abraham wasn't circumcised as soon as he began following God, and yet he was already declared righteous, justified, chapter 15. He wasn't circumcised until chapter 17, immediately after his adultery with Hagar, right? Bathsheba, I'm thinking of David, but so he commits adultery with Hagar, and then he's circumcised in the next chapter. And then circumcision does what? It's an external symbol. But Deuteronomy tells us that circumcision, that outward symbol, represents an inner transformation. It's the circumcision of the heart. That's what Deuteronomy says in the Torah. So circumcision of the flesh represents our docility to God, our ability to listen to God and follow him. And yet it doesn't effect that. Right? It wasn't meant to. And so what we see in Ezekiel, for example, right, we hear that beautiful passage of the sprinkling of pure water in the New Covenant, right? The sprinkling of pure water, the removal of the stony heart, and the being replaced with a fleshy heart. And if we read that in light of Jeremiah 31, of the New Covenant, right, not like the covenant of old. This will be a new covenant where the law is written on the human heart. This is baptism. Right? Baptism becomes the new circumcision. That it does what it symbolizes. Well, the Eucharist is the same. It does what it symbolizes. And so as I begin to study the Last Supper in its Jewish context, so many things come up. You start to recognize that the language Jesus uses is sacrificial. Right? This is the blood of the covenant. That's Exodus 24 language, right? Where Moses had his high priest Aaron and his 70 elders, right? And the 12 pillars, and they took the blood of the covenant. And they splattered it on the people and on the holy objects. Well, that's what's going on here. And of course, in Luke, we see especially this is the blood of the new and everlasting covenant that is shed or poured out for you and for many. So it's all sacrificial language. And again, this is only in Luke's gospel where we find Jesus has commanded to do this in remembrance of me, right? My anamnesis, my memorial offering. So you look at that, do this in remembrance of me, and we think, you know, well, this is nice just to remember this. You can't celebrate a Passover liturgy and think that, because if you go through the Haggadah, the story of the Passover Seder, and we hear from Hillel now the line that, you know, when you do this in remembrance of me, don't say when God rescued my ancestors from Egypt, when God rescued me from Egypt. The idea is that the memorial of the Passover is a reliving. It's a bringing to the present the event of God's saving work of the past. Well, if that's true of the Passover, how much more when God, as a man, says, this is my body, this is my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. As God said, let there be light, and there is light. Well, this is my body, and it happens. And so when you go to the Old Testament to look at memorial offerings, what do you find? You find the Passover, and you find the unbloody sacrifice of the bread of the presence. It's very interesting, right? Because in Hebrew, the idea is the askara, the memorial offering. And it's translated in two different ways in the Greek. You have the anamnesis and you have the nemasunan, which is refers to the Passover. So you have a bloody sacrifice of the Passover where the lamb's flesh is consumed, the blood is poured out, and the firstborn is saved. Okay? Then you have the bread of the presence, which is a related sacrifice given at the same time period. And what happens there? Well, the bread of the presence was to represent God's presence among the people. Hence, it was divided into 12 portions representing all the 12 tribes of Israel. And even up to Jesus' day, it was kept in the temple. And it represented God's presence among the people, and the priests would eat it in the holy place every Sabbath. It was the most holy sacrifice of the Sabbath. They would eat the bread of the presence and drink the wine for libations, all of which representing the presence of God. And so what Jesus is doing is combining all of these traditions. He's stepping into the history of Israel and transforming it so that the feasts of Israel become the feasts of the church. So he remains with us that way.
All of that wonderful continuity that you've expressed, the history of the old and the new, it gives the meaning to all that, to the gift of the Eucharist for us. That one little sentence in John 6, where unless you eat my body and drink my blood, you have no life within you, that has that Old Testament foundation.
That's right.
That unless you partake of the Passover,
yeah,
you don't have life.
Yeah.
So the continuity of that. And so if we take that as merely symbolic, then everything is symbolic.
Yeah, and it's very hard to read John 6 in a symbolic way. This is very difficult because, a lot of times they'll do this because it says, if you believe in me, if you come to me and believe in me, then you shall have life. And that's true. But if you look, you believe what? Right? So the whole point in John 6, first of all, John bothers to tell us it's the time of the Passover is at hand. Right? And so this is 3 years. No, I'm sorry. This is the second Passover in John's Gospel. The next Passover will be Jesus' Last Supper and crucifixion, right? So this is the year before his final Passover and his crucifixion. And it's a beautiful passage. So he's letting us know, the Gospel authors don't always tell us when things are happening. It's not important. But when they do, we need to listen because that's important. So it's the time of Passover. And the comparison is with the manna, which was supernatural food. I often lecture on this, and people say, I just thought the manna, the scholars on TV said the manna's insect excrement. Well, that's really strange stuff. It tastes like honey. Right? The amazing thing about the manna passages in the Old Testament are you had just enough portion, right, 5 days a week. It rained down 6 days a week, but only about five, just enough for everybody to eat, and that was it. And if you left any over for the next day, it rotted and got nasty and wormy. But on the sixth day, a double portion rained down. And if you kept that over for the next day, it remained. And then the seventh day, none came down. Right? And that lasted 40 years. I've never, it's miraculous. So it was seen as the bread from heaven. And so in John's Gospel, exactly what we see going on is we see Jesus comparing himself with the bread from heaven. And the work that you must do is faith. That's the key. Faith is not eating the flesh and drinking the blood of the Son of Man. Faith is the work you need to do to receive the flesh and the blood, which he gives us. It's a wonderful passage.
Wow. Well, we've had more time because I'd also would have loved to have you talk a little bit about faith and works in relationship between, as an evangelical, how you saw our faith versus now we put that all together as a Catholic.
Yeah.
I know it's a big part of your theology. Maybe just one thought on that. How do we help our separated brethren understand what we Catholics understand about works and faith?
Well, I think the biggest thing is this danger to scrupulosity. And I think the problem people think is, if it's about works, you have to earn it. You've got to be good enough to do it. And that's no. It's divine filiation, as we theologians say. It's about, we're children of God, right? We can't earn it, right? So we cooperate with God. Faith is a gift of God. Our works are gifts from God, right? We cooperate and he helps us to live this out. It's not about earning salvation. It's all grace. But both faith and works are necessary. They're two sides of the same coin. They work together. It's an obedient faith, as St. Paul tells us in the letter to the Romans, the beginning and the end. So our faith works out. Accepting Jesus as your Lord and Savior is a work. It's a prayer. But it's also a grace. All of these things are like that.
Yeah. I think what I've grown to appreciate over the years is the significance scripturally of being in Christ and then abiding in Christ. They're both true. It's not just a beginning. Yeah. It's the continuity for the rest of our life. And we're not left on our own to do that. We're given the graces, the church, the community.
Sacraments.
Yeah,
we go to confession. We begin again. As my friends would tell me, I can't live that. Well, I can't either. So there's a sacrament. Jesus knew that. So there's a sacrament for that. There's confession.
All right. Well, let's say we've got somebody watching that is sitting in the same place you were. What would you say about why they should come home to this wonderful church?
That's a hard one. Communion with God. To recognize that, that God loves us so much that he died for us. That's really the key of this, is that God loves us so much that he died for us, even if I was the only person in the world, right? Mm-hmm. And then the idea then is that we have to share that with others. We have to help make that real and live as Christ for others, and we're nourished to do that. So he didn't leave us alone.
And he gives us unique experiences and gifts so that we can be a better witness to others.
That's right.
I mean, I think about what you went through before your heart was open to the beauty of Christ, prepared you to be the witness that you are today for those that are going through the same issues of scientific materialism and all those other doubts and skeptics that you went through yourself.
That's right. I would say if you don't want to become a Christian or a Catholic, don't read C.S. Lewis and Peter Kraft and these people and the popes. Dangerous stuff.
All right. Dr. Morrow.
Thank you so much, Marcus.
Thank you so much for joining us on the program and for your continued work at Seton Hall. If anybody wants to find out more what he's doing, go to shu.edu, right? / theology, and that'll connect with what you're doing at Seton Hall Seminary. So thank you so much. And for joining us and challenging us on so many good things.
It was a pleasure.
In the program. Thank you. Thank you for joining us on this episode of The Journey Home. Dr. Morrow hit us with a lot of stuff tonight. I hope it was an encouragement to you, a challenge to you. Open the Word, open the Catechism, and open your heart to the fullness of the Church. God bless you. See you next week.